This is Running Free with JH. Today's documentary spotlight is Breaking 2, the documentary that chronologizes 6 months leading up to the race of actually trying to break the two-hour marathon barrier. That's 26.2 miles or 42.16 kilometers in under 2 hours. That was the attempt that was trying to be broken on May 6, 2017. Now, this was a documentary in conjunction with National Geographic Channel and Nike. Now, the Nike started this whole process back in 2014 when they had their scientists together. They had, which we had also a head project manager, a lead psychologist, performance engineer, and endurance experts, and coaches and trainers all came together to help find these athletes that they thought, that they felt could actually do this actual event feat. They picked three runners, and these runners, as you see here on the screen, were the runners they picked. Now, it's not exactly easy what they're trying to do. They're trying to run basically 4 minutes and 34 seconds per mile, or 2 minutes, 50 seconds per kilometer for almost 2 hours, just under 2 hours, the whole time. That was the goal that these people were trying to achieve. In the two years plus trying to actually come up with this breaking record attempt, they did a lot of things they changed. And they had to figure out the VO2 quality of each runner, the lactate threshold of each runner, the running economy each runner. They had to figure out all these different things to make sure that these runners were actually capable of doing what they thought they could do. They're looking at past performances that are going on right now, to see if they actually could improve on that to make it past the two-hour barrier. So this documentary does a great job in actually talking about the runners, who they are, where they come from, why they're running, what the two-hour barrier means to them, and everything. It's very a human piece in that aspect. We get to see their families and their coaches and how they practice running in the middle of the night at 3 a.m. because that's the time of the actual coolness of the temperatures and everything. It was great, very great on that aspect of it. Now, during the documentary, they chronicalized 6 months, 4 months, 2 months, 1 month, and then basically the race. And each time they have the scientists checking in with the actual runners, trying to see if they can help on the actual pace. They're bringing science in to say, okay, this is what your VO2 max is, this is what your lactic threshold is, where's your running economy is, here's where you're at, here's where you were before, this is what you've been doing. We want to change this to help you get better at that. And they do a good job explaining why they're doing those change-ups to their coach. They work with the coach, they work with the trainers, and they explain all of it together in a scientific way, plus in English for us that speak English, or what language it is for them, to actually make it sense. So that way the runners can actually perform what they're trying to perform. And the best part about this whole thing that I thought was by far, each runner was so on board. The runners were, the trainers were, and we get to the actual race event. All the pacers were on board. Everyone was there. The goal was not to get one runner there. The goal was to get somebody across the finish line under 2 hours. That was the goal. It was definitely a team effort. It reminds me of Roger Bannister when him and his two colleagues in the UK and Great Britain basically tried to break the 4 minute mile barrier. It's almost just like that. It just makes me feel so happy and that we are doing this, bringing science to the mix. Now, so that's most of the documentaries about going back and forth between the science and the actual runners, and back and forth about how the training is, how they feel about how the science is, and everything about that to actually make the actual event. That's basically what it is. The last 20 minutes of this documentary was on the race on May 6, 2017. That was about it. Basically, it did a cap of every, like, almost couple miles, how the race was going, what was going on, if they're getting off pace or on pace, everything. Now, I won't spoil it for you to actually explain if they broke it, they not broke it, and everything, or what happened to each of the three runners. I'll let you watch that and be surprised on your own. Now, overall, this documentary was fantastic. I love the fact getting into the minds of the runners, the science explaining a lot of it, of why they had to do certain things they did in order to achieve the actual event. It was fantastic that way. Now, some of the things I think that could have been improved on this were basically, they didn't really explain why they chose each runner. They talked about what their hopes were, but they didn't talk about how long it took to find these runners. They talk about the ways they went to find these runners, or if word went out, because I never even heard about this in my running circle at all until it was actually being done. I saw it in like Runner's World and Competitor Magazine, and I saw some YouTube videos on it. That's when I first heard about it. So I would love to see more of that in this documentary about what happened prior to the 6 months, where these people came from, how this started in Nike, what happened, and who actually got the ball rolling and said, we're doing this, we're going to put this much money in, let's do this. There was not much discuss on the check-ins about what's happened before the check-in, what's going to happen after check-in. There was the check-ins they talked about, but there wasn't much before and after about what's happening during those 2 months. Are we going back to the science board in Oregon? Are they back there? Are the runners back in their home country? And what's going on? Are they doing Skype calls? Are they doing emails back and forth? Are they talking? Are they actually changing things up week to week? Are they getting real-time, day-to-day feedback on how the runners are doing? We don't get any of that, and I wish they actually would include that to actually talk about the progress. It would have been a lot longer documentary, definitely, but I think it would have been very great. And a lot of these actual articles that came out about this actually went in depth in those things. Now, like, even the actual race itself, in the link below in the show notes, I'm going to actually have the link to the actual race itself. It's about a three and a half hour roughly YouTube video, but it actually shows everything from the time the race, before the race starts, all the way to the end. And it's actually narrated by, you know, Paula Radcliffe, Craig Masbach, and Sal Mesquela. I'll put the words right here. And they actually document this, and they're like the running commentators as people are running, and they're talking about things throughout the whole time. And as they're going through, they're doing little snippets of people's lives of the extra runners and what they did to get there. So those little snippets are great. And also Kevin Hart's part of this documentary, because he's giving some on the ground feedback in his comic relief, basically. Overall, that was not talked about in the documentary, but it is in the link I'm going to show you, which I thought would have been helpful to actually talk about what is going on there and everything. Another thing I think they could have done a lot better job at is talking about why they picked this track. They did pick the track. The location was a track in Monza, Italy. It's the home of the Formula One's Italian Grand Prix, where the fastest cars get the fastest laps in the world there. It's a 2.4 kilometer loop around, and they had to do loops around this thing because it was all flat. It was at 600 feet above sea level, you know, it was at 50 degrees. It was perfect temperature, perfect everything. And they explained a little bit of why they chose that location, but it would have been interesting to see them take a few minutes and actually talk about what other locations they were looking for and why they chose this location, not that location, but why this location. They did ultimately say why this location, but it would have been interesting to see them scouting the other places. They didn't talk about that much. Now, other things I think they could have talked about, because this was big. A big pivotal thing that runners talk about are running shoes. It was never discussed in the documentary about the running shoes that were created specifically for these people. And I'm including the notes below the running shoe I'm talking about. It's called the Nike Zoom Vaporfly Elite is what it's called. And that, in the link below, you're gonna see the actual shoe, what they did, how long it took to make it, and they went back and forth with the runners on how to actually get the shoe perfect. Every single runner, every single pacer ran with this, Plus you had people right in the shoe that were in the Olympics. They all ran with these shoes because they're all testing to get to that. So there's more people involved in this shoe that we never hear about in this documentary. And I think also, because the documentary was about breaking 2 hours, not just the people, but the science behind it. And I think this would actually have brought more science to the actual documentary. So that's kind of something I wish they would have done more of. And that's okay that they didn't. It's still, this documentary still held its weight on its own. Basically, that's kind of like about it, how I feel about the actual documentary. Fantastic. If you want to know kind of what was involved or how these people did over the course of like 55 minutes is how the documentary is, this does a great job doing all of that. If they do try the tip again, because, okay, now I'm spoiling it for you, they didn't hit the 2 hour mark, but they were so close. If they do this attempt again to break the actual barrier, because let's face it, it wasn't a world record, because according to world record rules, you have to have a pacer the whole time in order to be a world breaker. And what they did was they put pacers in and out every so often, so that way they have fresh legs to hold the pace, so that way the runners could keep going the whole time. And that did not qualify for Olympic or even, excuse me, a world record. And they weren't trying to do that. They even said on documentary, they're not going for a world record. They were going to prove that this can be done. So they didn't care about that. They were just trying to actually do the record. I think if they actually made the actual attempt and they succeeded, they would try it again with paces that did the same thing, so they have more people doing it. So overall, that was good. I would like to have them, if they do this attempt again, to have the chronicle of a 2 to 5 year journey of this. Because it seems like to me they got people within a year of doing the race, and they actually started really training with them in about 6 months. I think if they did this for 2 to 5 years, and they said, okay, we're going to break this attempt in 5 years. Here's what we learned from the first attempt, and here's what we're going to do in year one, year two, year three, year four, year five. And I think if they did that, we might actually have more success and actually be a lot better the second time around if we did it that way. I know it's a lot more difficult doing that because you have athletes who are who are in their own careers. They have their own sponsors and they have to do certain races in order to get paid and everything. So it definitely gonna cost money to do that. It would be these people who have to actually get out of their regular running programs when it comes to actual racing and actually start doing a program with Nike. Whether they do some races in those program, it's okay. I think it's okay. But I think if you did a 2 to 5 year build up to this actual race and what they're trying to shoot for, it would be a better way of doing it because it'd be more focused and you have a couple of years to get to where you want to go instead of just 6 months. Because 6 months is a long time, but in the scheme of things, 5 years is a lot better to hone in on where you're trying to go. They accomplish so much in the two and a half years of actually from the first day they said we're going to do this to the actual time they actually did the actual event. The team itself, they did a beautiful job. They accomplished so much, and I believe that was awesome about it. Now, going forward, like I said, if we did this over a 2 to 5 year period, got people that were on board and say, this is the person's going to do it, and we're going to be here in 5 years at this day, and this is when we're going to do it, and that's where they do it, I think it would work a lot better. And they film the whole thing. Make it a documentary series. Not just have a one episode like we have right now, 55 minutes. Make it like a Netflix show. It's 10 episodes, maybe have them 45 minutes a piece, and they chronicleize it. That would be so much better. Or do it a YouTube video or something on Facebook or something. I think it would be great. But overall, I like this documentary very much. And I hope you like this series. And see you on the next documentary spotlight. Oh, also, I'd love to hear your comments on this. Did you watch the documentary? Are you looking at the links below? Have you seen what your thoughts are? I'd love to hear from you. Comment below and let's have this conversation go further. And if you want, you can always email me at runningfreewithjh@gmail.com. Have a fantastic day. Get out there and run.